If cholesterol is really so bad, why didn't natural selection just handle it for us? This is a super common question, and I think there's two layers to it. One layer is more superficial. It's basically when people say, well, I don't believe that cholesterol poses a problem ever, because otherwise nature wouldn't have put it in our bodies. That's just a basic misunderstanding. Having cholesterol in our body is not a problem. It's having a high cholesterol level in the blood that is a red flag. Just like having high glucose in the blood is not a good thing, and yet nature put glucose in our bodies. Same with high sodium or high potassium in the blood. Most parameters have a physiological range, and if they're too high, they can cause problems. So that's more straightforward. Now, a more sophisticated version of that question is, if high cholesterol is a problem or an indicator of problems, why didn't evolution just come up with a solution for that? Like capping our cholesterol levels, for example, just not allowing them to go above a certain range, or coming up with some protection, some mechanism whereby even if they do rise, the cholesterol level rises, we're somehow immune to that and we don't have any issues. And of course, the same question would apply to glucose and potassium and all these other things. Why didn't we just evolve protective mechanisms against all that? So there's a few possibilities. One possibility is that maybe our ancestors never had high glucose or high cholesterol, or had it so rarely that there was no evolutionary pressure to come up with a solution. Or maybe they didn't live long enough for it to be a problem. Since these are chronic diseases, type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular disease, that normally take a while to cause serious problems and typically hit later in life. Yet another possibility is that the same trait provided some advantages and some disadvantages, and the net effect was worth it for our ancestors. So this is the idea of antagonistic pleiotropy that we've talked about in previous videos several times. And it's a fancy name, it's a big word, but all it means is that the same factor has multiple effects in different directions, some good, some bad. The classical example of antagonistic pleiotropy is sickle cell. It's a genetic condition where your red blood cells become flattened in the shape of a sickle, and it raises risk of death in children. So it tends to be weeded out evolutionarily, except in some regions, like for example, some parts of Africa, where it persists, and it's even common. So why would that be? Because that same trait also provides an advantage. People who are carriers of the sickle cell gene are more resistant to malaria. They're less likely to die or to have serious complications from the infection. So in areas where malaria is endemic, where it's common, carrying the sickle cell gene provides an advantage that offsets the harm. Whereas in other areas where there's no malaria, so in most of the world, it's clearly a net negative to carry that gene, and so it gets weeded out. The key take-home message here is that different environments can make the same trait be adaptive or maladaptive. There's a very interesting paper by some cardiovascular researchers that argues that something similar might have happened to cholesterol, that our ancestors lived in a harsher environment where food and calories were much harder to come by, so genes that helped them store energy might have been advantageous. These authors call them thrifty genes, basically genes that help us save and store energy and prevent squandering it. So their idea was that storing fat and having more of these fat transporting vehicles in our bloodstream, like lipoproteins, may have been protective, because the priority was to have nutrients and energy stored up in the system to avoid malnutrition and starvation. And everything else was secondary, like longevity or what happened 30 years down the line. So they hypothesized that genes that increased the number of VLDLs in our bloodstream, VLDLs are these large lipoproteins that carry mostly triglycerides, which are a form of fat, may have been adaptive in this harsh and calorie-poor environment. Now, VLDLs, as they progressively deliver their triglyceride cargo to tissues around the body, get increasingly smaller and eventually become IDLs and finally LDLs. So the idea is that these lipoproteins helped distribute energy throughout the body, which was advantageous during times of famine and energetic scarcity. But as nutrients became more abundant and ubiquitous, this same capacity to store fat and to have all these fat vehicles, these lipoproteins floating around in our bloodstream, became maladaptive. Because nowadays, we're not at risk of starving anymore, most of us Westerners. But we live pretty long lives, and these lipoproteins, when they're in high number in our bloodstream, can get stuck in the artery walls and can cause plaque to gradually accrue, to grow over the years, and can eventually lead to heart attacks and strokes. And this has become our number one killer. Regardless of whether the details of their theory are right or wrong, whether it pans out or not, the general concept is that something that arose as a survival tool can sometimes become a handicap if the environment changes, and vice versa, right? A weakness can also become a strength in the different environment, like we saw with the sickle cells. So it's just not as simple as, well, if X was bad, evolution would handle it. Evolution doesn't plan ahead, and it has no way of knowing if and when and how the environment will change. In fact, even now that our propensity for heart attacks and strokes has clearly become a major problem and a handicap, there's still no guarantee that evolution is going to do anything about it. As the authors explain, natural selection is ill-equipped to control hypercholesterolemia's prevalence today or in any era, because its adverse manifestations generally occur beyond peak reproductive years. In other words, because the bulk of the heart attacks and the strokes and the cardiovascular death happened in our 60s and 70s and beyond, and because by that time we've done most, if not all, of our reproducing, it might not be too relevant, evolution-wise, whether we suffer or die at that later stage in life. Point here is, we have to be wary of these one-liners on social media that seem to make sense at first glance. Things are a lot more layered than that. And there's many reasons why a trait might persist evolutionarily. From it providing an advantage in one environment but not another, to it just not being evolutionarily very relevant, even if it's a huge deal for us. If you have an interest in these questions of nutrition and evolution and health, we have a full interview with a paleoanthropology professor going over everything that's known about what our ancestors ate, and we'll put it right here. And we have a second video on nutrition and evolution where we talk about these principles of antagonistic pleiotropy and all that fancy wording. All right, and we'll put it right here, so check those out. Let me know your questions below. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.